Welcome to the IDP Talk. My name is Rahul Kumar, and I am the Associate Director for Canada at IDP South Asia. It is great to see so many students and parents attending this panel discussion. We hope that through this session, you get to know about a lot of exciting new opportunities around studying in Canada. We are all living in uncertain times. The ongoing global pandemic has disrupted all fields of human life, and higher international education is no different. From switching to online classes from a normal face-to-face format, from closing down campuses to now carefully reopening them for students with obviously strict safety protocols, the last 11, 12 months have also been a huge learning experience for everyone. But now that things have slowly started to get back to normal, Indian students have started to show keen interest in Canada once again. Some important questions that are there in everyone's mind are, what's next? How are things going to unfold? What should students know? What are institutions doing to ensure safety and quality? What are some of the new opportunities to study in Canada? There is a lot of buzz around public-private partnership campuses in Canada. What is that all about? Today, we have got a fantastic panel of experts from Canada to discuss all that and more. I'm very happy to introduce our panel of experts to you. Our first panelist tonight, Ms. Sonia Takkar, Director, Student Recruitment for South Asia and Middle East, Canadore College of Applied Arts and Technology, Canada. Welcome, Sonia. Sonia, I think you'll need to unmute yourself.
Thank you, Rahul. Thank you for arranging this talk show and for the introduction.
Welcome once again. Our second panelist tonight is Dr. Chris Anstead, who is Dean of Business at Georgian at ILAC, Canada. Welcome, Chris.
Thanks very much. I'm very happy to be here, and I look forward to seeing the questions and the participation from the students and their parents.
Our third panelist tonight, Mr. Milan Petrovich, Vice President Academic at ILAC Canada. Welcome, Milan.
Pleasure to be here.
Well, welcome again, everybody. Let's get into the panel discussion. The topic for our session today is explore opportunities in Canada. And as I mentioned, there are a number of questions that students have in their minds. So we'll try and cover all that in the panel discussion today. Before I get into the panel discussion, I would like to encourage all the attendees to put your questions in the Q&A tab. So as many questions as you want, please feel free to put in the Q&A tab. We have reserved the last 10 minutes of this 1 hour session to answer some of your questions. So please feel free. And I'm sure that a lot of your questions will be answered in the panel discussion anyway. So please pay attention to the discussion also. All right, so I'd like to open the discussion with you, Sonia. How do you compare the pre-COVID and the current times as far as international education is concerned, from Canada's perspective? What has fundamentally changed?
That's a very interesting question to start with. I think last year has been quite a crazy journey for the ones in international education, I'm sure. Online education was not something radical and was not something that happened just after COVID. It was happening before also. But what was radical about Canada was that it was allowed and with no impact on post-study work permit. So that rule kind of gave a lot of confidence to students to continue studying online. So that was really interesting to note. And I am in this industry for past 5-6 years, and I am in a traveling job. And in past 1 year, I have not traveled to meet students around different countries, but I've done only the online education fairs arranged by IDP and our other partners. So it's interesting to note that without travel, we have been able to interact with so many students and parents around the world with the help of technology. I mean, we were not dependent on technology that much pre-COVID the way we are now. It has its own issues. For example, I started speaking without unmuting myself, so it has its own issues. And then there are students who do not have the right internet connection. I did a fair in Nepal. Student was far away in mountains in a village. I was glad that with technology I could connect to him, but he had issues. So that has changed. We are pretty sure that classroom teaching cannot take over online teaching cannot take over classroom teaching. It has to stay. But what has helped is the technology that has helped to stay connected to each other. And also, I must appreciate IRCC with all the rules and regulations and the Canadian government. If you compare it to any other country, let's say New Zealand, they've done a tremendous great job in, making sure that COVID doesn't spread. But what measures have been taken for international students, I'm not pretty sure the way Canada has done it. So these are the changes that I saw pre-COVID and post-COVID. Our dependency on technology has increased, and I think we can continue to kind of connect with each other to the places that we can't travel to. But I'll be happy if we resume classroom teaching, because that has a different impact on students. They are paying so much because they want to experience Canada, because they want to experience the Canadian classrooms. So I think that's it.
I absolutely agree with you, Sonia. And in fact, the travel bit, I really miss that too. So I'm sure a lot of our students and parents and our team members miss that. But I hope that things get back to normal very soon. Coming to you, Milan, how is your institution handling the current situation with respect to COVID-19?
Well, I think our institution has really been at the forefront of dealing with the COVID crisis. We were one of the first on the language side institutions to institute online classes, and currently we have over 3,000 students taking our language classes online. It has been a fast transition for us, and I think it's been rather successful. On the college side, we've been doing online and blended classes for quite a long time, and so there, that was probably an easier transition for us. We've been able to accommodate students in many different ways through classroom recordings. One of the things that we try to do is try to have as many synchronous activities as possible to mimic what it is that you get in the classroom when you're on ground. One of the benefits of having an online class is you have asynchronous activities that students can take part of. But we feel that synchronous piece makes it, it just gives us that flavor of being there with the instructor. And because of that, one of the things that we've done with our classes in the Vancouver schools is offer different times that students can be available online, so that we can accommodate students in different parts of the world. So that's been something that we feel, it's important for us to give the experience that you would get when you come into Canada, and to prepare students for when they eventually do come to Canada.
Yeah. Staying with you, Milan, tell us something about ILAC and what is your relationship with Georgian College and Red Deer College? I understand that you are a PPP partner with Georgian and Red Deer.
That's right. ILAC is the largest and most recognized language school in Canada. As I said, we've got over 3,000 students online. Usually on ground, it's many times that. And because of our standing, we've been able to form a partnership with Georgian College and host one of their campuses on our ILAC campus in Toronto. With Red Deer College in Alberta, we acquired a school in Vancouver called Sterling College. And Sterling College had an existing relationship with Red Deer where they offer a dual credential. So students studying at Sterling College in Vancouver receive a credential from both Sterling College as well as Red Deer. What that does in both cases is it gives students an opportunity to get postgraduate work permits, which is very important, as you know.
That is great to hear. I'll quickly circle back to my first question to you, Milan, with respect to COVID-19. At both your PPP campuses, are you prepared to offer face-to-face classes to international students for the upcoming September intake?
Yes, we are. In fact, I can tell you that we've been offering face-to-face classes in our Vancouver campuses pretty much almost uninterrupted through this entire period. We've put in existing measures in terms of social distancing, reducing the number of class sizes, providing PPP for students, which is personal protective equipment. So students have to wear masks. If they have to interact with a staff member, there are plexiglass in front of the folks. So it's quite a bit of a different experience in terms of being able to come together. And I know students like to exchange hugs and shake hands and those sort of things. But with the social distancing, it creates a slightly different classroom, but it does create that sense of community as well, simply because they are there together in the classroom.
Well, thanks, Milan. I'm sure our students will be excited to hear that. Coming to you, Dr. Chris, what are the advantages for students to study from your campuses? How does it impact the work opportunities that students would get during and post their studies?
So our campus is located right in downtown Toronto. So it's very different from the main campus for our partner, Georgian College, which is located in Barrie. In Barrie, they have wonderful opportunities to engage with Canada's northern attractions or semi-northern attractions. But in Toronto, the advantages are more around a diverse city. Canada's chief financial city, Canada's largest city, and a city that's very welcoming. So in our campus, we will take advantage of the fact that we are located in Canada's most developed economy and bring in people into our classroom, whether it's virtually or whether it's in our physical classrooms as we go forward, who represent all those different opportunities for our students. We will partner with other firms, with commercial firms. We've already established relationships to bring projects for students to undertake that are real world projects, to offer tours again when we're back to our physical location, to have guest speakers in the classroom, and all these other opportunities that you can get from being in a city which has big banks, big manufacturing, big hospitality industries, pharmaceutical industries. We have manufacturing, auto manufacturing around the edges of Toronto. So this wide exposure to a variety of opportunities, a variety of potential outcomes, a variety of potential employers will all be baked into every one of our programs and each one of our courses.
Follow-up question, Dr. Chris. I know that your campuses are going to offer global business management, project management kind of business programs. For our students to understand the difference or similarity between the Indian way and the Canadian way. So in India, what happens is there are campus placements. So companies are invited on the campus and students are able to give job interviews on campus. And sometimes they're selected from the campus also. How is it going to work in, for example, the Toronto campuses?
Well, ILAC already has a very established career development, career opportunity staff on hand. So we will be taking advantage of those individuals that are already highly trained and have these existing relationships with Toronto employers to set up, whether it be a career fair, whether it be an employer visit. But I think what we're really going to add to that as a college will be this one-on-one relationships. We have employers that are already talking to me that want to get in our classrooms, want to judge case study competitions, want to be part of marking assignments or providing assignments. And so much of that is going to really take place in a one-on-one opportunities where students will have face time with generally the sponsor of a project, who is probably going to be somebody who's a hiring manager already, but at some point in the process, we'll be able to present to more senior people in that organization around, let's say they were asked to tackle a problem in supply chain. So the sponsor might spend a couple of hours over the course of a term working with a team of students or several team of students on that specific supply chain problem, at the end of the whole process, they would have an opportunity, or at least the winning team, the most successful team, would have an opportunity to present their solution to a panel of perhaps more senior people from that organization, or maybe from across multiple organizations. So I think establishing those one-on-one connections, networking with the instructors who all come out of industry, many of them already or will continue to work in industry and will themselves bring their networks to the class. Those one-on-one relationships will really be the major way in which students will discover opportunities that they might not otherwise come across.
Yeah, so networking is the key. Thanks, Dr. Chris, for that. Coming back to you, Sonia, tell us something about your institution. We understand that your institution also has a campus in Canada through the PPP model in Toronto, in fact, and our students would love to hear about that too.
Okay, thank you, Rahul. To all the attendees, I must give a quick brief introduction about Canadore. So we are a public institution in the province of Ontario, and our main campus is in the city of North Bay, which is around three and a half hours drive from Toronto and is also the same distance from Ottawa. We do have a public-private partnership with Stanford International College, and they have three study locations in Mississauga, Scarborough, and Brampton. So we do open programs at our main campus, as well as the public-private partnership in all the intakes. The program offerings differ. If I quickly give you a brief about the programs that we offer, there are about 80 plus full-time programs ranging from media, aviation, design. We have programs in healthcare, a bouquet of programs in business and management. So a lot of choice for students, and the program offering at the public private, I don't know why I get on mute. So the program offerings on the public-private partnership are less in number. So the programs are the ones in which the need is only of classroom study, and the programs do not require a lot of laboratory setup. They're all business management programs that are offered at public-private partnership.
Sonia, we are not putting you on mute, that is for sure. We want to hear. Some problem with Zoom, as with all technologies. So Sonia, we also hear some student concerns around quality of education at some private campuses of public colleges. What are your views on that? How are you going to ensure that students have the same experience at your PPP campuses as they would have at the main campus? Now, because you're speaking on behalf of both campuses, I think your best place to answer that question.
Yeah, I will be very transparent in what I'll be answering. So it's been 5 to 6 years of this partnership, and I haven't seen students' demand or concerns, demand going down for going to public-private partnership. Whether we accept it or not, we know that the demand for Canada has, increased many times in past few years, and we also know that many students want to go to Canada to study, and many of them want to go to Canada for PR. That's one of the reasons that the demand is increasing day by day so much. If I come on the quality assurance, whenever I meet students or counsel them, or if I talk to my partners, I do inform them in advance that a public-private partnership campus will not be as huge as our main campus is. So a public-private partnership campus might not have the same huge library that we have in our main campus, or the sports facilities that we offer at our main campus. So it is up to them to decide if they're looking for a very good campus life or college experience, or they want to stick to the education. They want to do a program with a good classroom facility and laboratories for computers. And that is the reason why the programs that we offer at public-private partnership, they're all business and management program, which do not require a lot of setup. As far as quality assurance is concerned, I have seen that and observed that in the past few years, that the faculty or the professors that teach at our public-private partnership locations. They are some of the part-time faculties that teach at other institutions also, be it Centennial, Sheridan, or other public institutions in Ontario. So as far as professors are concerned, there is no quality issue. Also, there are ministry guidelines that institutions have to follow. The deans are expected to do audits per semester, be it in terms of the faculty that are teaching, be it in terms of the student attendance, and the way things are being managed at the public-private partner. So a lot of that follow-up and all the policies and regulations are obviously given by the main campus at North Bay. So now we know closely how the private campus handles everything. So on and off, we do get emails because students have the right to kind of write to anyone in the organization if they have any concerns. So the kind of concerns that I receive would be somewhere maybe once or twice in a year, mentioning that they're facing some problem or they have an issue with any professor. Apart from that, I'm talking about myself, I have not received any quality issues so far. But yes, students are informed in advance. They have to make their own decision. They will definitely get a more exposure in the main campus, more Canadian experience in the main campus. But it is their decision to choose the location, which is obviously an advantage because it's in Toronto, vis-a-vis North Bay. So it is their choice. But as far as quality of education, the credential of Canadore is concerned, I'm pretty confident about the delivery of the program and the way things are managed at our private partner.
I think you are absolutely right, Sonia, because if somebody studies at the main campus, there are advantages to that. And if somebody stays in a big city like Toronto, there are advantages of that also, because there are larger companies, there are bigger setups there. So you're absolutely right. It has, both the systems have advantages. So coming to you, Dr. Chris, what are your views on that? How are you ensuring top quality experience for students?
Well, that's a great question, Raul. I think one of the things I like about that question is we consider critical thinking to be a really important outcome in the programs that we're teaching. We've designed our programs not just to cover domain knowledge, but also to cover employability skills like critical thinking. And to see questions like that come up in a panel like this is really a great sign of what kind of students we're attracting. My short answer is really Sonia's hit a number of the points that I would also reinforce. So from a quality of academic experience, or sorry, from the academic experience, you're getting the same experience whether you go to our campus in Toronto or the campus in Barrie. What you're getting that's different is the other side of the experience, the non-academic experience, which I'll talk to in a minute. But as far as the academic experience goes, yes, there are absolutely the same expectations. The credential is exactly the same. And our partner, Georgian College, has established a very comprehensive and thorough quality assurance framework to make sure that what we're delivering is in fact exactly at or exceeding the level of quality that they're expected to provide to their students and that the ministry, the Ontario government expects Georgian to provide. And in fact, the ministry itself can audit our relationship. They can make sure that in fact Georgian is sending out observers to talk with our students, to interview our faculty, to sit in on a classroom, or to otherwise, or even physically assess the environment in which we're teaching. So we do have that quality framework in place. The curriculum has been approved by the government. It has been designed by Georgian and it is provided to our faculty to teach to. The outcomes are provided to our faculty to teach to, and the minimum requirements for our faculty's credentials are enforced. Now, we feel we exceed those minimum requirements. As Sonia mentioned, the faculty that we use also teach in other programs. We have instructors who teach in some of the MBA programs at some of Canada's best known schools. We have instructors also though that have very deep industry experience or have been important stakeholders in industry so that, again, they're making sure that we meet or exceed the quality requirements expected of all Georgian programs, whether they're delivered in Toronto or at one of the seven campuses that Georgian operates. On the other side, though, what is different is the experience. As Sonia said, Georgian, very much like Canadore, is a beautiful, large campus full of domestic students. So if you want to go and really be kind of have that college experience, the experience of being on a large campus with all the campus facilities, with a large number of Canadian students, and in a small urban place where you can get that not exactly small town feel, but kind of that small urban feel, then you go to Barrie. If you want to be in a very small campus, which is really intimate, which allows a lot of face time across all staff, which is 100% dedicated to international students, and which is located in Canada's most diverse and welcoming city, then you can come in and study with us in Toronto. Either way, you're getting the same credential and the same education.
That is really reassuring, Dr. Chris. Thank you for that. At this stage, I would like to encourage our students to ask questions. I'm just reminding everybody that ask questions. This session is also broadcasted live on Facebook. So all the people who are seeing this on Facebook, feel free to post comments over there. We'll try to get back to your questions as soon as possible. So Milan, what additional support services can students expect as in any support services around accommodation, airport pickup, et cetera?
So that's one of the things that I think we do really well at ILAC and that we're very proud of is our department for homestay and accommodations, as well as activities outside of the classroom and extracurriculars. It's one of the strengths that we believe that we bring to the relationships. And actually, it's one of the reasons why Georgian College sought out ILAC for this partnership. They wanted to find a partner in the Greater Toronto Area who could provide the kind of services that, let's face it, students can't get in Barrie. And, you know, our students who come to ILAC, you know, participate in regular, you know, extracurricular activities, great trips and visits and things of that nature that we really hope to return to very quickly once the COVID pandemic starts to wind down. In terms of homestay, we have a great staff that provides students with you know, many different types of choices in terms of homestay, whether it be with a private family or whether it be in a different type of setting. You know, they work with students from the very start. They'll pick students up at the airport. They'll bring them to the homestay. They'll set up their accommodations. One of the things that Canada introduced recently is a requirement for students to spend 3 days in a hotel prior to you know, getting into their quarantines, and that can be very expensive for folks. And one of the things ILAC has done to address that is to provide an $800 credit for all the students who come to our campus who have to go through that to help offset those costs. So in terms of services, I think our offerings are very robust, and you know, the kinds of activities and supports that we offer at the campuses are you know, equivalent and in some cases better than what a student would get going to the main campuses.
Excellent. All that is really exciting, Milan. I hope students are getting excited about your campuses in Toronto. Sonia, what's the return on investment for students from India? And in India, we cannot shy away from talking about return on investment because we are all very, very sensitive about that topic. What is an average salary or pay package that an aspirant from India can expect post-studies, both from your main campuses as well as from campuses in Toronto?
Okay. So if I talk about return on investment, that's a very common question that students and especially the parents ask in India. The main concern is about jobs, and the mentality is like the same that if, like in Indian institutions, in Canada also companies visit and they do interviews and this is how students get placed. That's what people think about. If I talk about the average cost of the program at Canadore College, it's around 15,000 Canadian dollars. Definitely there are programs which are costly than this and reach up to 22, 23 per year, but the average is 15,000 Canadian dollars per year. students are not only worried about the final placement, they're also worried about whether they can work while they are studying in Canada. That's a major question and concern for students. So yes, Canada does give that opportunity to students wherein they can work for 20 hours per week. And if you look at the minimum wage in Ontario, it's $14 an hour. And if the student is able to make, if student works like about 10, 15 hours also per week, they're able to make about $500, $600. And if we talk about a one-year program, that is, if they do an 8 months program, they pretty much make around $4,000 to $5,000 in that time period. So I'm not speaking on behalf of all the students, but this is some of the students that I've observed that they do it. And for some of the students, they don't, for them, part-time is not important. They focus on their studies, they focus on networking. They're different kind of students. But if I talk about the final placements, it also, again, depends on student to student and also program to program. Because there are students who do very specialized programs. For example, I know students who do digital cinematography, post-production, environment technician. These students are doing specialized programs, and I've seen many of those students getting $70,000, $80,000, and some have gone up to $90,000 as well. But then there are a lot of students from India who, after grade 12, they go and study and they do diploma programs like business or computers. So I'm not trying to discourage, but then they have to start from the very basic level jobs. So for them, the package would be somewhere around 45,000, 50,000 or 40,000. Students start with those basic packages. So if you look at the return on investment, it is a pretty good return on investment when you spend $15,000 or maximum $25,000 on your education and you're earning part-time in Canada. Canada gives that opportunity while you're studying so that you can manage your expenses. And then when you start working, which students do, get a job after their full-time program, they start with 45, 50. That's the basic I'm saying. And the specialized ones, they reach 60, 65. It depends from student to student. And the maximum that I've seen, they go up to 90 as well. So this is a pretty good return on investment.
Thank you, Sonia. Milan, what are your views on that?
I think Sonia hit a lot of the major points there in terms of salaries and opportunities. For our students in going to the Red Deer PPP, looking at the IT programs, our IT programs, both in software development and in network administration, they represent in many ways the first 2 years of a Bachelor of IT. And so because of that, students have the opportunity to proceed into longer programs to earn a bachelor's degree. But many of them will choose because of the great salaries that are available in that industry to go right into industry after those 2 years of training. And I can tell you that here in Vancouver, the IT industry is really booming, and there just aren't enough people for the jobs. And that is something that is one of the reasons why there's a big boom in immigration. There's a big boom in bringing people in from wherever we can find them, to be honest. And the same holds for Toronto. So, I think Sonia said it very well. It's a great return on investment for students who are coming in. We try to, as Sonia mentioned with the PPP programs, we try to make sure that our programs are hitting high demand industries and areas where people will be able to get jobs. And the other PPP program that we have is in internationally educated nurses with Red Deer. So we're talking about nurses who are registered in their own countries, but immigrating to Canada and need to get certified. That is a huge demand, obviously with COVID, that is becoming it. But before COVID happened, there was a huge shortage in Canada for nurses. And what we do is we provide those folks a pathway to get them to certification. The certification process is varied from province to province. And that's something that you'll hear about Canada. Things are different in each province. even amongst COVID. COVID is a bit different in Ontario than it is in BC or Alberta or some of the other provinces as well. So it's important that students educate themselves in terms of, you know, what the situation is in each province. But that opportunity to become a certified to get their certification in nursing in Canada is a great opportunity given the need and also you know it's a very fast pathway toward PR. So that's something that that we feel is a great strength of our program.
Raul, do you mind if I add? My colleagues did great, gave us a great answer in terms of the return on investment for your diplomas. In terms of the graduate certificates, I think it's also important to point out that in many cases, our students will have invested already 4 years in an undergraduate program that maybe they're not feeling they're getting that ROI. Maybe they took a four-year chemistry degree and you know, haven't been able to find a job in the industry that really aligns with that. But if you take add on top of a chemistry degree or a music degree or an arts degree, you know, a one-year program in project management or a two-year program in global business management, suddenly you're an attractive candidate for significant roles in, say, the global pharmaceutical industry, the global mining industry, food manufacturing. So there is a way to actually use some of our programming to actually leverage that investment you put into those more academic domain areas and really turn it around to something that can give you a career for the rest of your life.
Those are great points, Chris.
I know, absolutely, I agree. Great points. In fact, from both of you. And Milan, if I can push you a little bit more, I'm just out of curiosity, you know, what about the part-time work opportunities? I mean, is there an infrastructure to support students to find part-time opportunities also?
Yes, in fact, we have staff who are dedicated to that very role in terms of making sure that students are able to support themselves. Most of our students do work part-time, and finding those opportunities and those roles helps them to become more secure in Canada, but also fixes them in the community and makes it possible for them to continue their studies and in a comfortable way. So it's something that that we're very proud of in terms of the support that we offer, and you know, getting students to get up to that 20 hours. In some cases, holding them back to that 20 hours is more the case. But you know, we're very proud of the support our department offers to the students.
Thanks for that, Milan. Dr. Chris, we've also heard a lot about co-op and internship. What is co-op? I mean, I know what is co-op, but it'll be good if students also hear from you. For the Global Business Management program at your campus, for example, how easy or difficult it is for students to get into co-op?
So the Global Business Management program is a recent program. It was designed just 2 years ago, and it's been designed to completely meet the needs to for our students to graduate and be certified as FIT International Business Professionals. That's the accreditation. But the short answer to your question is that doesn't involve a co-op segment. The way in which we've designed the program, we didn't feel it was necessary to include a co-op requirement there. So that means there's no challenge for students to be admitted to our program who have to worry about being also able to find a co-op. In fact, we've injected all the industry know-how through the faculty, through the curriculum, and through our partnership with FIT, Forum for International Trade Training. So in that case, there is no concern. Now, I know that doesn't answer your question about what co-op is, but I think maybe I should leave that to another panelist since I don't actually have co-op under me.
All right, I'll go to Sonia with that question.
So we do not have too many programs that have a co-op option, but for the attendees, cooperative education is kind of a paid internship as part of your program. So when you're pursuing your program, you get an opportunity to work in an organization and you get more in-depth, extensive knowledge of that industry, and you're able to kind of give some suggestions to the organization you're working at. It's a win-win advantage for the organization. the institution and the student, because the student gets paid for it. If I talk about Canadore College, instead of co-op, we call it more of experiential learning. So a lot of our programs have experiential learning component, like culinary management, recreation therapy, environmental management, where students are expected to work 100 to 400 hours, depending upon the program, with an employer. And this is a voluntary work experience. And so they might get paid or they might not get paid. So we don't call it as co-op for our programs, but experiential learning. I hope that answers the question, Rahul.
It certainly does. Thank you. So coming quickly to you, Milan, you have been known for a long time for the languages programs, right? So do you think there might be a perception related challenge now that you're attracting international students to your programs, which are larger in nature in terms of academics?
Yes, in terms of ILAC is a well-known brand, and while that's an advantage in getting name recognition, it also gives people an impression that that's all we do. And the fact is that we've had a college brand, ILAC International College, under ILAC for at least the last several years, and as we've expanded the ILAC brand to bring in schools like Stirling College in Vancouver and Canadian Tourism College in Vancouver, as well as starting this these partnerships with schools like Georgian College with the PPP and Red Deer College. You know, we're expanding what we're known for, and I believe that as time goes on, it will be the word of mouth of our students and the success that they achieve in both industry and academically that will continue to build our brand. And you know, we our CEO has a very important statement that he says there's nothing more important than brand, and brand is what people say about you and what people and how people view you. And it's very important for us to be to continue that that strength for our organization.
Thanks, Milan. Coming back to you, Dr. Chris, you know, a lot of our students go for business-related programs in Canada. So if I have to give you a percentage, every year close to about, you know, 30-35% of students that we send in total to Canada, those students go for business-related programs. So my first question is, what are the kind of programs, business-related programs, which are being offered through you guys? And especially, you know, we get a lot of questions around project management and around project management professional certification examinations also. So could you talk a little bit about that?
Sure, I'm happy to do that. That's kind of two different things. So I'll start with just a summary of the programs we're offering, and then I'll focus in on the project management certification process. So we're very happy to be offering three different programs at this point. We expect to add a couple of more over the next, probably over the next year. But at this point, we have three programs. I've already mentioned the Global Business Management program. This is a graduate certificate. So it's aimed at people who have already have an undergraduate diploma or degree. And it really is, it's a very focused program in the sense that it builds to a single whole. The final set of activities that the student does in this program is to create a project that speaks to all the different dimensions of global business. So whether that's financing, supply chain, HR, marketing in particular. And so what that means is that our students come away with a very rounded education. There are foundational components, but there's this very specific focus on international business, which really sets them up for opportunities in any business that's operating globally. As Milan mentioned, because of coming out of ILAC, a lot of the students that are in the program are students for whom English is a second language, and that has the opportunity in an employment situation of presenting bilingual candidates, which is a very attractive advantage for students when they're going for these global business opportunities. So that's one of our programs. It's a graduate certificate program. I'll leave project management aside. So the second one I want to talk about is our general business program. This is a two-year program. Again, it's a comprehensive and foundational program. It covers all the areas that you would expect in a management education program to cover. In fact, we're talking about having some additional certification related to that. And so what it does, it either allows students to go into industry, to go into really any organization as a, well, in some of the roles that Sonia mentioned earlier, you could be a coordinator in just about any department, whether it's HR, IT, supply chain. You could go in as a management trainee, as a salesperson, customer service supervisor, things of that nature. Or as Milan mentioned with his IT program, it could also serve as the basis of the first 2 years in an undergraduate business program, or as a launch pad to go into more specialized certificates and learning in an area that you really want to focus on. So again, it's a very practical program taught by practical people with very significant and real working opportunities at the end. Project management, as you can imagine, there are a lot of project management courses out there. Our course is a one-year graduate certificate. It requires individuals to come in with an undergraduate degree, a diploma, or a significant work experience. And it is framed around the requirements to write the PMP, which is the project management professional, the global recognized accreditation for project managers. But it's much more than that. It's a full year in which you'll learn not just the project management book of knowledge, which is the core PM book, but you'll also learn portfolio management. You'll learn quality management. You'll learn leadership. We've got a very strong leadership course that we offer. This is one that's taught by somebody who teaches the same leadership program at one of the best MBA schools in Canada. And so the project management program, certificate program, at the end of the year, you graduate with the Ontario Graduate Certificate, Ontario College Graduate Certificate. And at that point, you are set up to pursue your PMP, your designation. You can immediately write the examination for CAPM, the Certified Associate in Project Management. But to get your PMP designation, which is really a worldwide credential, you need three things. You need project management education, you need to pass an exam, and you need experience. So we look after the education side, we look after it and more, and we help set you up to write the exam, but of course you need that experience. Now, maybe you brought that experience with you coming into the program, maybe you had 2 or 3 years experience in projects. If you don't, then you have to step away from education for a bit and you have to gain that experience. And the PMP requirement around experience varies a bit from country to country, depending on where you're writing the exam. In Canada, I believe it's 36 months of project experience, some of which has to be in a leadership role, but not all of it. So for a typical graduate who hasn't done project management before they took our course, they probably have to do 3 years of work before they can finally write the PMP and emerge with that designation that says they are a recognized, experienced, trained project manager. They can put that on their resume and hopefully find a promotion or a new career that really reflects what they've achieved.
Thank you so much for that elaborate answer, Dr. Chris. Really appreciate it. Sonia, coming back to you, what kind of scholarships international students can expect? And if possible, can you give some examples of the scholarships that students would have got in the past?
I've heard the scholarship part of the question. Was there something else before that?
No, only the scholarship. That's the only question. Okay. So, yeah.
Okay. So, as far as scholarships are concerned, at Canadore College, we do have merit-based scholarship, and we do have some entry-level scholarships, which are without merit. So, if I talk about merit-based scholarships that are open to all international students from all around the world, wherein we look at a particular percentage in academics, and we also look at English proficiency, which is IELTS. So if students are above the mark that we have set for the scholarship, which is 90%, for undergrad students. They get a scholarship of up to $1,500 Canadian. And we also have scholarship based on English proficiency. So we have a different amount associated with different IELTS requirements, starting with 7, 7.5, 8, and 8.5. So we have many students coming in at 8 also, and a few at 8.5, and they do get the requisite amount. And if they're able to fulfill both these conditions, the scholarship gets combined. In addition to that, we also give scholarship to students who have played at national or regional level in their countries. Specifically for our program Strength and Sports Conditioning, we also have a Global Green Scholarship of $1,000 Canadian for our students who pursue environmental management. Apart from these scholarships, which are open to all nationalities, we are trying our best to recruit students from around the world. So we have some entry-level scholarships for students from Morocco and Bangladesh and Bhutan. So these are some entry-level scholarships that we give to students from different countries.
Thanks, Sonia. So we are in the last 10 minutes of this panel discussion, but before I move to the questions, I'd request all the panelists here to have closing comments, maybe one and a half minute each panelist. What's your top advice to Indian students right now from your respective institutions' perspective? And Sonia, now that we are with you, we'll start with you.
Okay, great. My advice to all the students is that I have seen a lot of positivity around studying in Canada, and that has continued in spite of the pandemic last year. So we have seen a lot of students studying online, even if they were not able to travel. And I am sure with the COVID regulations and the vaccine coming out, I'm sure the things are going to change. So don't be demotivated. Canadian government as well as IRCC and institutions, they've supported the students throughout this year, and that will continue. So keep up that motivation for studying in Canada, and we are more than happy to kind of help you with any queries that you might have. So just have patience and don't have anxiety and stress, because I've dealt with a lot of students past year. I have faced that they were a lot more anxious and stressful than before because of the changing regulations. So just stay positive and be motivated.
Thank you. Dr. Chris.
Thanks, Rahul. I'd like to add to what Sonia's saying. I think if you think about coming to Canada, you know, first of all, I think that's a great idea. And I think if you come to ILAC, you'll find you're not just coming and sitting down in the middle of Canada, and you're not just sitting in a classroom that's being transplanted from India and put in Toronto. You're going to be sitting in a diverse classroom. Because we're a language school that attracts already students from South America, from the Caribbean, from Eastern Europe, from the Middle East, from Korea, from other parts of Asia, what you will experience at ILAC and in Toronto is a very welcoming, diverse community where you can learn to interact with students who come from all these different cultures, where norms are different, expectations are different, learning styles are different, and you can really benefit from that. You'll also find that our faculty and our staff themselves have this diverse background. Almost everybody that works at ILAC has immigrated at some point. I immigrated early in my life to Canada. And so they understand the immigrant experience, the new Canadian experience. If they're not themselves immigrants, their parents were. Not everybody. We have a few people with deep Canadian roots. And so from them, you can also certainly learn what that type of experience is. But it's a very diverse experience. And so I certainly encourage it.
Thank you, Dr. Chris.
Milan? And I would echo everything that Sonia and Chris have already said, and add that what I've seen talking to prospective students is there's this uncertainty and this hesitancy to get started. And my advice is very simple. Don't wait. You know, get going, get started, because Canada has done an incredible thing in making it possible for anyone who starts a program that has a postgraduate work permit to get the full benefit of that work permit and regardless of whether they've come to Canada or whether they've taken that entire program online. Get your education started. There are some benefits to starting in India and then finishing in Canada. One of those benefits is the cost. It costs less, obviously, to study from home than it is to come to Canada. Once you're in Canada, it's a wonderful experience. You won't regret it at all. But at the same time, holding things off makes it even more difficult to get things going. You know, it's all about getting that momentum going towards study in school. And the fact is that Canada is a safe choice. It's a great choice. And it's one of the top choices. If you look at the international students around the world, they come to Canada because of the quality of the education here, the quality of the institutions, and the recognition of the credentials when you leave your education. The fact is that it's a growing country with a vibrant job market and great opportunities. So take advantage of it. Don't wait.
Thanks so much, Milan. Really appreciate all your comments. I am happy to share with our esteemed panelists here that we had received over 200 questions in the last 1 hour. And my team has been at it, and they have answered most of the questions. But I have saved a few questions for you guys. And one question which has been asked by a lot of students is on the offer turnaround time. And this question is for both Canadore as well as ILAC institutions. Whoever wants to go first.
Can you repeat that question again? Sorry.
The question is around offer turnaround time. So if somebody applies today, how long will it take to get the offer? Assuming that they're eligible.
We try to turn around offers as quickly as possible. You know, depending again on the student's credentials and their paperwork and making sure that they're able to provide all the necessaries for their application. We try to turn that around in as much as we can within 2 weeks, if not faster.
Yes, I know I've heard reporting that we're turning it around in about a week's time currently, although as numbers go up, that may drag a little bit more.
Wow, 1 week is awesome. Sonia?
I would say 1 week is our target, but because of the current volume and the way things are going on because of a lot of changes, we are taking up to 2 to 3 weeks in some cases. But usually we, you know, generate an offer in a week's time and 2 to 3 weeks in some cases.
Sonia, a lot of questions are coming for you. And one of the questions is, will face-to-face classes return for the September intake? Can students assume that if they go to Canada, they'll get face-to-face experience?
We have not announced the academic delivery plan for September yet, and it will totally depend on the situation around COVID-19 in Canada and the vaccination being done there. So I would say that for a lot of programs, like in September 2020, we had hybrid delivery. The same will continue. But for the programs that were completely online, I cannot comment on it right now because the decision is not yet made.
Okay. All right. But we are hopeful that things will get back to normal in September. So
we hope that too as well.
Okay. For ILAC, some students are asking how to connect with your team. So I think I can answer that question. All our IDP. So we are present in 40 odd offices in India, 40 plus offices in India, and you are welcome to contact any of those offices and our counselors will be happy to help you. If you are interested in the institutions of ILAC or Canada, our teams will be happy to help you apply to those institutions. Anything that you would like to add, Dr. Chris and Milan?
Absolutely. We're a great partner with IDP and you know, definitely trust them to get you to the right people.
Yeah, absolutely. It, certainly that's the appropriate channel.
Well, most of the other questions that students are asking, we have already covered during the discussion, and my team has also answered those questions live in the chat window. Well, I think we are at the end of the panel discussion. I would like to first thank our esteemed panelists for sparing your valuable time in participating in this particular discussion. Really appreciate your time. And thank you so much to all the attendees who logged in and spared their valuable time to attend this panel discussion. So thank you so much, everyone, and we'll see you soon.
Thank you. Great pleasure.
Thank you so much, Rahul. Have a good weekend, everyone.